Hi David, you're here because you did a talk at .css, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we thought like it's a good idea to invite you into Prismic Studio. You do a lot about CSS and JavaScript, and especially like you do a lot about animations. I guess it's kind of interesting, and
yeah,
thought it made sense. When did you land in Paris? When did you come to Paris?
I came to Paris 2 days ago.
2 days ago.
Yeah.
And you took the plane?
I did. Yep.
Yeah.
Long plane ride.
where are you coming from?
So I live in Orlando, but I had a connection in Mexico. Yeah. And so I had to come from Mexico all the way here.
So you're jet lagged or not, not anymore?
I don't know. I had enough coffee, so I think I'm good.
Okay. So first, what got you started with the JavaScript and CSS and all that? How did you get started with that?
From the very beginning, I was actually in school for music. And one of the last classes was we had to make a website from scratch, but they wanted us to use this drag and drop interface called iWeb, if you remember iWeb. But I didn't want to do that. I wanted to do it all by hand. And so that's where I learned HTML and CSS and eventually JavaScript.
So you had to do a website for doing what? For composing?
Oh, music? So not for composing, but for marketing yourself as a musician.
Ah, okay, just that. Okay.
Yeah. And then when my teacher saw that, he said, you should do this as a career. So that's what I did.
you're in the wrong place.
Exactly. Plus, it makes a little bit more money than being a musician. So.
But you still do music, right?
Yeah, I do. I play the piano.
Piano?
Mm-hmm.
Cool. And then what happened then after like this revelation?
So I started working at the college that I went to, and we were doing a lot of PHP, a lot of web design. And after that, I joined a startup where we did even more PHP, but I got more involved in the JavaScript and the dynamic user interfaces. And so that's what I focused on from there.
And then slowly you started focusing on animations and transitions,
yeah,
and stuff like that, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because animations I got into because my background in music, I just, see and feel things in a very, creative way. And animation was a creative outlet for me. Whereas working in PHP and backend, that's not really too creative. So I just wanted to play around with CSS and see what I could do.
Right. And what was the first thing you did with CSS? The first complex thing, let's say.
First complex thing. There was an animation where it was a weather app where it showed you every day and there was like animated clouds and things like that. But when you hovered over, it would switch to the day and then the cloud would just stay still. It was this really cool illusion effect where it showed it sunny, cloudy, rainy, and all of that. And so I posted that animation on CodePen and a lot of people actually liked it and they were sharing it all over. And I was like, okay, maybe I should do more of these.
Right. And like you just mentioned something, illusions, because when people get into animation and transitions, they always think about doing, a physical word. But mostly there are a lot of tricks and illusions that you have to play with to make things look more fluid and more, it's like magic, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And so there's many factors that come into play to making animations look lifelike. And also there's, speaking of illusions, there's this technique called the flip technique, where if you see like one element in the page that smoothly transitions to another, there's actually a lot of trickery that goes on to make it look like it's moving, even though it's actually in its original place, but then you shift it back and then you transition it back.
I would like to dig more deeper into flipping another video and the technique and other techniques. But yeah, so are there a lot of these kind of tricks when you're doing animations?
Yeah, there are a bunch of tricks, and we talk about that in the keyframers. We do a weekly series where we just do animations.
And it's like, why am I saying, like, did I say that it's like magic? Because often magic tricks are like you kind of moving something quickly, and it sounds as if it was some other movement, but
right,
it wasn't,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Like you kind of move the cards, and suddenly you think that they moved from here to here, whereas like new ones appeared and some mm-hmm. disappeared.
Yeah,
and this is the kind of tricks like you do sometimes you have to do in CSS to make things look more fluid.
Exactly. Even if you, especially if you're doing animations where you're not using any JavaScript at all, you do have to use a lot of those tricks.
Because what happens otherwise? I mean, if I imagine like I'm starting with CSS and JavaScript and mm-hmm. I see an element, then the first maybe intuition is to say like, okay, I will move it slowly from here to here, and I will actually move the element and, you know, do the actual thing. The easy thing is to say, okay, let's move it from here to here, which means change its position from here to here. This is what you would think about right away.
Right.
So that the straightforward way, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why is that doesn't work all the time?
So it doesn't work all the time because in CSS, there's two properties that you want to only animate, which is opacity and transform. And so if you're trying to animate something like top, left, width, or height, that's going to cause performance problems. It's going to cause a very janky layout. So that's why in order to have a very smooth user experience, you have to use some of those tricks.
Right. And like, okay, now, you know, people are using more and more animations, like even in websites and apps. And, you know, a lot of our audience are people who are building websites. And there's always mm-hmm. this kind of debate. Should we use animations or are they an overkill for a website? How much of animations should we use in the website? How much will it like be bothering for the experience? How much of it is good? What do you think of that? Do you think like animations should be used a lot or like we should find the right place? Of course, like, you know, this kind of debate is interesting because animations are exciting,
mm-hmm.
but still you don't want to abuse the experience.
Right. So in my personal opinion, it depends on the user. If the user decides to, that there's a setting called prefers reduced motion where you could add a media query and you could say if they don't prefer animations, you could shut the animations off or at least dull them so that they're not as prominent. But otherwise, animations can be a very good thing and could be a very useful tool in enhancing the user experience. But
so wait, just you said like you can put a media query and yep. give the preference to the user.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah.
Didn't know about it.
Yeah, but there's a lot of websites and web apps do sort of use animations superfluously too, which is not always good. You have like flashy everywhere. What you want animation to serve, like in terms of purpose, is you want to direct the user to doing something. So you want a single focal point instead of having just everything show up everywhere.
Okay, that's a good, so the rule is use animations to draw the focus to some place.
Exactly.
You want them to kind of yeah. focus on one point, and that's how you transition from one focus point to another focus point.
Yeah, basically. That's the purpose of animation.
Okay, I like it. I like mm-hmm. it. That's a good rule. So anything that distracts is not exactly good.
Right, yeah. I mean, have you ever played with an app or a website where there was an animation, you said, oh, that looks cool the first time, but after 10 times, you're like, how do I turn this off? This yeah. is very annoying.
Right, yeah. It happens a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And also like when, you know, often people abuse also things like, simple things like mouse hover.
Right.
It becomes like dancing all the time because you're moving your cursor and it becomes like confusing because you can't focus on what you're trying to mm-hmm. do. This is basically what you're talking about.
Right. And that's another thing too. When you do animation, you want it to be short and concise. You want it to be around 300 milliseconds or so, like just enough so that the user understands what's going on, because if the animation is too long, that's going to frustrate the user.
So animations, another thing you're saying, animations are there to make users understand what they're doing.
Exactly.
Basically, like yeah. if they saved, they should know that they saved. Like if they are like, for instance, choosing a call to action, they should mm-hmm. understand the animation will help them to understand that they did what they were supposed to or they what they intended.
Right. And that's why I always say to prevent these jump shots that I call, where you do something and then immediately the view changes, like just like that, or something disappears. And then the user is confused. It's like, where'd that thing go? Or like, well, what do I do next? Well, what am I supposed to focus on? But instead, if you have a smooth animation, then it's going to help guide the user.
And how, like, imagine I'm like interested in doing that, and I'm doing a career in animations, mm-hmm. like you did. How can I get these guidelines? What should I read? Where should I go to be able to understand what is right about doing animations? Because, you know, when you get into that world, first you want to animate everything because it's so amusing, right? Mm-hmm. And then you need to kind of build that experience of like, this is the right thing to do and this is probably not right. These are examples. Where would you advise people to go to learn about these kind of things? You have a podcast or something, a series.
Yeah. So we have a weekly live stream called The Keyframers, where we take animations from Dribbble or from other sources, and we try to make them using HTML, CSS, and maybe a little bit of JavaScript. And so we do talk about these guidelines on the show, but honestly, a lot of my inspiration comes from people like Rachel Neighbors, Val Head, And what's her name? If you go on timpanist.net/codedrops, that's a really great resource too.
Mm-hmm.
I think her name is Mary Lou, but yeah, they have written books and have a lot of talks on just proper animation guidelines and techniques.
And okay, like, do you see some products today that you think they do animations right?
On
the web, like things you say, oh, I like how they do things. They're doing it right.
Yeah, two of my favorite examples are Stripe and Square. So
okay.
Stripe, if you go on Stripe's homepage or any of their documentation pages, a lot of their animations, I mean, they're famous for their design. Like,
oh, they're really good. And their DOM is good. Their website is really, they do, yeah.
You know, when everyone tries to copy you, you're doing something right. And so that's the case with Stripe. And with Square, too, everyone has interfaced with a Square payment system at some point in their life, or at least a lot of people have, where it's just a very smooth enter your card. It shows you a nice animation. It's like, all right, here you go. Your order is placed. Sign here. All of that. And it's a very clean user experience. And that's why when you're using a product like that, you have confidence in it. And companies, you know, use it because they're like, we are offering a premium product. Mm-hmm. And so that's why animations provide that sort of clean feeling.
Right. But it's a lot to learn, right? Like, it takes several years to have that kind of experience and that to be able to have that judgment on this is the right way to do or this is not.
Right. And one of the problems too is that with a lot of learning today in the web, there's not too much focus on animation because animation is seen as the sprinkles on top, like just the nice stuff that you add at the very end if you have time. Which, I mean, no one ever has time, right? We're always working up to deadlines and even skipping deadlines. So sometimes animations are just forgotten.
Mm. Or just done like very quickly at the end of the project, or let's add animations.
Exactly.
Being part of the UX experience and the UX thinking, basically.
Mm-hmm. Right, and depending on how you build the project, adding animations can actually be difficult, which is another reason why they're forgotten.
Mm-hmm. So did you ever like try to take some like good websites that use good animations and remove the animations and see how it goes?
I have not, but I can imagine that.
It should be interesting to see, like, maybe it can show how much animations are, subtle animation are important in these kind of cases, how much they bring in the UX, because maybe we don't feel it.
Right.
It becomes like we don't see it, but they are there and they do their purpose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there are ways to turn animations off in websites. And honestly, when I see a website or a web app without animation, it just feels very rigid. And it feels like it's less quality, but also it feels like I'm going to be more confused about what I need to do next.
Right. So maybe in the next video, we talk about some of the tricks that you talk about
sure.
for doing animations. We start with flip, probably.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks.